So today's guest has been an animal trainer in Hollywood for 20 years. She has done numerous TV shows and feature films providing and training animals. So guys, I am happy to bring you animal trainer Sarah Clifford.
Hello.
Hello. So first of all, tell me how this all got started. How did you get into Hollywood?
Well, I've been in Hollywood working for 20 years, but I've only been an animal trainer for about 17 years. So I started out as a PA, actually, and I was working on a movie, believe it or not, called The Matrix 2. I don't know if you saw that, but and there were trained crows on it. And I remember working as a PA, and I was still trying to figure out like what I wanted to do in the business. And I knew I really liked working behind the scenes, but I didn't know specifically what job I wanted to do. And I remember when the crows came on set, like the trainers had these like little crates for their crows and these, you know, their little khakis on. And I was just like, that is so cool. Like they, you know, and the crows were trained to do their action very well. And it was just my light bulb moment where I was like, I think, you know, I always loved animals from the time I was a little girl. And I was like, I think that is what I want to do for the rest of my life. So I actually, right after The Matrix 2, I looked into it and I, you know, was like, how do I do this? And that's how, you know, it all started for me.
Okay. How many animals do you currently have right now?
At my ranch, I'm actually kind of more of a, like a mom and pop type of, you know, company, I guess, because I'm smaller. I don't have like, we don't have like kennels. Hello, Oscar. He's visiting. And we don't have like, you know, we keep everything very like kind of organic here. So I have 13 dogs currently. We have a couple horses. We have a couple pigs. We have chickens, roosters. We have a mini horse, and they all are trained to do movie work. So I have about 25 animals roughly. But none of them, you know, stay in kennels. We all have like big play yards and pools, and they all sleep inside at night. So we treat them like family members, which is a little different than some of the other animal companies.
So 25 animals is obviously a lot of animals for one person. Which of them was the hardest to train?
You know, all the animals have their unique characteristics and personalities. I mean, obviously dogs are man's best friend. And, you know, dogs are probably the easiest to train because they, you know, our communication with them is, you know, so advanced. But I would say when it comes to training, like, you know, it depends. Like, I had to train some geese before for a movie, and that was pretty hard, training geese, you know, because they were shy, you know, shy animals. And so having to have them on set in front of a crew of 200 people, and I had to train one to wear a tutu and circle around, and, you know, and so, but I did it, but it was challenging. But they're, you know, I don't really think any animal is hard to train as long as you understand the psychology of the animal. Like cats are a little different. Cats, you know, having them on a set is a little more challenging because they're, you know, environmentally sensitive. Right. So like a noise can scare them, but but they are highly trainable. You know, you can train cats to do a lot of cool stuff. Yeah. So there isn't really animals that are particularly hard to train. They're all just different, and you just have to understand them and what their needs are and what motivates them.
So training geese, that would have been crazy. Is that the most exotic animal you've ever trained, or is there something else that's a little more?
I actually did a Jennifer Aniston movie where I trained an opossum, and that was very interesting. Like I had it living at my house, you know, during the duration. But the opossum was, you know, it was trainable, but it was just kind of like I had to understand what, you know, made it think and motivate it to, you know, want to do what I wanted it to do on set, you know. And usually it's food motivated, obviously, but sometimes it's, you know, with dogs, it's praise or toys or things like that. So you just have to, careful, but you just have to understand, you know, what, you know, makes the animal want to do what you want it to do, you know?
Right.
And in a positive way, you know, it's that it's enjoying it and not that it's, you know, being forced to do it.
Right.
Huh. I've trained rats and mice before too. Most people don't realize you can train mice, believe it or not. Like little tiny, you know, mice that you see running around. I've trained mice to actually hit a mark, to stay, to actually carry like a backpack. In one of the Fred movies, the little mice had to actually wear a backpack and go inside a pizza box and eat pizza. And so you can actually train. It's amazing what you can do. You can train anything. I've trained rats to pick up things. I've trained chickens to carry things, to hit a mark, to my rooster to crow on cue, you know? So it's kind of amazing what animals can do, you know?
It really is. So what, I guess we could call it a trick. What was the most difficult trick that you've ever taught a dog specifically?
My first dog who, hello Oscar, was Kuma. He was the first dog that I ever trained to do movie work. And I actually rescued him from the shelter when he was just a puppy. And one of the most complicated tricks I've ever trained a dog to do was I trained Kuma to pick up a coin from the ground and to put it in a piggy bank, an actual little slit of a piggy bank with his mouth. So that was pretty complicated because most people didn't think that could be done. But I remember seeing, I don't know if you know who Benji is, but Benji back in the day actually put a penny in a Coke bottle. And I was like, if you can actually train a dog to do that, I bet I could train a dog to put up, you know, a coin in a piggy bank. And I trained him to do that. And we were on a TV show actually with Cesar Millan as the judge. And he was like, that is the most impressive thing I've ever seen. He was like, holy crap, I can't believe you were able to do that. So that was one of the more impressive tricks. But you know, I've trained, a lot of really cool, intricate things, you know, like walking on the hind legs and just, you know, being able to pick up items, like open their fridge and get like a drink. You know, yeah. A lot of people do that, but that's always a fun one to train and things like that. So, yeah.
So, is it possible for any animal to be trained?
Yeah, I feel like there are going to be some animals that, like a rattlesnake or something like that, that is more about handling the species than training it. The word train is more like you're actually teaching them, you know, like a teacher would teach a student, teaching them to do something specifically on cue. Then, you know, like if you're on set with like a lizard or a snake, it's more wrangling, you know, than anything. But there are, you know, arguably there are some reptile people who have been able to get their, you know, reptiles to do things on cue, but it's more or less directing them. And like when I've wrangled bugs before, on set, like butterflies and cockroaches,
ew. You know, like
maggots.
That's a little gross.
I've actually, like, one of my first jobs as an animal trainer was a TV show back in the day called Angel. It was from way back in the day, and there was also a TV show called Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and I worked on both of those. And on the TV show Angel, I was still interning, and I had to go and like take maggots and put them in like a fake dead body. And I was like, I don't know if I could do this, but I didn't want, you know, to look like a wimp. So I wore gloves and they were stinky and it wasn't the best thing in the world. But, you know, when you're an animal trainer, you have to kind of be comfortable with any species, you know. So I kind of overcame my fear and I didn't think I can handle those big hissing cockroaches. But I've had to use those in film a lot. And I'm totally fine with them now. You know, they don't bite or anything like that. So if anything, I'm not crazy about things that like will physically harm you.
Right.
But other than that, I'll handle anything. There isn't anything I'm afraid of.
In that sense, handling anything, what is the most difficult animal you've had to handle? Not necessarily train, but just be with.
Huh, let me see. Well, I don't really deal with a lot of exotic animals. You know, I mostly do like dogs and cats and, you know, domestic animals, but there isn't really anything dangerous I've dealt with or anything too extreme, you know. I kind of have done everything from guinea pigs to rats to chickens to cats, mice, you know, baby ducks. opossum. That was kind of the most exotic thing I've ever handled. You know, I've been on set with, you know, tigers and lions and bears and stuff like that, but just as a, you know, observer and safety person, not actually handling those animals. So, yeah.
If you could train any animal on the planet, what would you want it to be?
If I could train anything, oh, for sure, I would want to work with, I always, like, back in the day, early days, I thought I wanted to work at SeaWorld because I love marine animals, and it would definitely be a killer whale, an orca.
Okay.
I'm obsessed. I love them, you know. Obviously, I love them being out in the wild, but in some circumstances, those types of animals are dying from being in the wild, so some of the places like SeaWorld actually... you know, are giving them the best care, you know, imaginable around the clock. And I definitely don't ever see, like to see any animal taken from the wild.
Right.
But if it's already in captivity, it should, you know, and can't be re-released, then I think it should get the best care. And those trainers love those animals and give them the best care. So that would be cool. Dolphins, whales, all those things are fascinating to me.
Okay. Is there an animal that you're afraid of?
No.
No? No animal at all?
Nothing in the world. No, there's nothing. I think that, like I was saying before, venomous snakes aren't my thing. You know, I have, though, been called to provide rattlesnakes before on set. And but I hired somebody who knew how to handle rattlesnakes, and I was just like the safety person, you know. But even rattlesnakes, like, they're not really vicious or mean. Like, they're just scared most of the time and protecting themselves. So again, I think as an animal trainer, if you understand the species and know, like, there isn't really anything that's particularly, like, out to get you, they're just doing their thing, you know, instinctually.
Yeah.
So no, there isn't anything I'm afraid of. I like spiders, I like snakes, I like bugs, I like everything.
Bugs,
I love every animal.
Honestly, in my personal, this is obviously just my personal opinion, but yeah, if it has more than four legs, I think it should just
be away from
stay
me.
Stay away from stay me away. A little bit.
A little personal space.
Yeah.
I feel ya. No, I'm not, I was a weird little kid. I would literally, true story. I didn't really care for my stepmom, my stepmom when I was a little girl. And she was terrified of snakes. So one summer when I was your age, I went out and I went to the beach and there was all these gardener snakes, which are harmless. Okay. They're not poisonous. And I took a whole bucket and I filled it with snakes.
No!
And then I went, this is a terrible story, and then I went to my house and I, like, you know, I knocked on the door and I took the bucket of snakes and I poured them all over the front porch. Not to be, like, cruel, just to be funny. And she came to the front door and opened it and saw the snakes and literally almost passed out. She almost had a heart attack. And I got in trouble, but I was doing it as just to be funny, you know? I wasn't trying to, like, give her a heart attack, but yeah, that didn't go over too well. So I was a little girl who caught a bucket full of snakes, so yeah, kind of an odd one.
This is a kind of childish question in a sense, but if dinosaurs were still around, do you think you would be able to train one?
That's a cool question. I would want to try, that's for sure.
Well, I mean, really, who wouldn't?
I mean, that would be cool. I mean, yeah, I imagine the dinosaurs could be trained, because really, like, the theory is anything that eats is trainable. You know what I mean? Because you're using that as a reinforcement for what you want it to do.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, when we do clicker training, we click and pay them with food as a reinforcement for what you want them to do and repeat. So I definitely think I could train dinosaurs.
Yeah.
I'd be an awesome dinosaur trainer.
I wouldn't suggest opening a theme park.
Yeah. No, probably not.
So how much dog food do you think you go through in a month with all 13 of your dogs?
You know, interestingly, I definitely spend a whole lot of money on dog food. It's a big number. I'm not going to scare you with it, but we go through a lot of dog food here. I just did my taxes and the number was staggering. So yeah, we treat them well though. We give them the best diets, you know, cause these are all working animals. And, you know, my philosophy is, like, we take really good care of our animals. We treat them like family members. So, you know, I actually cook veggies for them and meat and all kinds of fancy. They eat better than I do. So, yeah. A lot of money goes to this, making sure they're healthy, huh?
And out of all of the animals that you have here, because you have like chickens, horses, dogs,
yeah,
which animal eats the most?
That would be a tiebreaker between my horse. That weighs, you know, the horses are weigh around 1,200 pounds.
Yeah, horses are huge.
And rhino, my Great Dane.
What? Okay, I thought it was going to be a tie between the horses and the pigs, not the big Great Dane. Oh my gosh.
My Great Dane weighs 140 pounds, and he's on a very special diet because he's actually allergic to most meats, which is very odd.
That is.
So he's allergic to chicken and beef and things, so he can't eat like normal proteins that most dogs would eat. So he has to have a very fancy palate. So it's very expensive to feed him. Yeah.
Okay. Now with the pigs though.
Yeah.
Do they, like, what do they generally eat? Like, do you cook them food or do they just kind of eat anything?
The pigs actually, you know, it's funny because they don't actually eat as much as you think they would. Like, you know, it's the saying where like pigs eat anything and everything, but they, you know, pigs are actually, their DNA is very similar to humans, believe it or not. So they can actually eat anything we can eat. Like if I wanted to, you know, like they can, you know, they'll eat whatever you give them, but obviously, like, you know, things that aren't healthy for us, like McDonald's and stuff, aren't healthy for pigs. So I give them like salads, fruit. They love nuts, just things like that. Yeah, anything that's healthy, bananas. They love spinach. So things like that. Yeah. And then they eat like a regular, like organic pig food for like their normal, like a pellet, you know.
Right.
So. Yeah.
This question's kind of riding on the edge. I don't know if it's going to be a bad question or not, but having two pigs, do you still eat bacon?
I don't. No, I don't.
Nothing like that?
No bacon for me. I'm actually, well, I'm not a vegan. I don't eat meat. I have chickens and they're all free range and, you know, they run around my property all day. So I occasionally eat eggs. But I will only eat eggs from my chickens. I don't like the factory farm, right, you know, ones. So I don't eat any kind of meat, no. And that's just a personal choice.
Well,
but,
yeah.
You know, but I don't, you know, obviously I don't judge people who do eat meat. I just choose not to.
Well, yeah. I mean, I can see why you would choose not to, being surrounded by animals 24/7.
Yeah, absolutely, for sure. Yeah.
So on set, what is the biggest number of animals you have had in one room?
Well, when I worked with you back in the day, we worked on a TV show called Mutton Stuff.
Yeah.
And I would say that was a pretty, like, we had 13 dogs on that show that were mostly on every episode. So that was a pretty large amount of dogs. And then there were episodes where we had, like, baby chicks and ducks and baby bunnies. And so collectively, I think, like, you know, one of the episodes we probably had in our trailer, we probably had, like, if you were counting all the baby ducks and baby chicks and baby bunnies we had, plus the dogs we had, and we had kittens, we probably had like 40 animals on set at one time, you know? So that's probably the most. Back in the day, I did work on a movie called Hotel for Dogs. I was just like an additional trainer on that. And that, you know, that movie, they had probably, gosh, I don't know, like, over 100 dogs on that movie, you know, for the running scenes, you know.
Oh my God.
That was intense. Yeah. Yeah.
25 animals is what you currently said, roughly, you had.
Yeah.
Is that the most animals you've ever had at once?
Probably. Yeah. Yeah, probably. I like to keep my numbers low, you know, because if you have like, you know, if you have more than 20, 30 animals, it's really hard to give them individual attention and give them the care that, you know, the really good care. So I try not to have too many animals because I want all the dogs to get attention and, you know, get to go on camping trips and get to go hiking with me. And in the more, you know, the more animals you have, the harder it is to do. So I would say like 25, 30 has been my max.
Have you ever met another animal trainer that has, say, 50-something dogs?
Oh, yeah.
Or not necessarily dogs, but animals in
absolutely.
General?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I have. The first company that I worked for, they had, like, like 200 animals.
Wow.
And unfortunately, in that situation, it wasn't a, you know, it wasn't something that I like to see. You know, it was the animals weren't getting good care, and there was a lot of issues. And so, you know, and then they were in small kennels, and they just, you know, they didn't get the attention that my animals do. So I kind of like based my company on what I wouldn't do. You know what I mean? Like I didn't want to have that many animals, because there are animal companies, not all of them, but a few of them, that they just have so many animals because they want to have all the different breeds and stuff like that, that, you know, like if they get a call for a Dalmatian, they have a Dalmatian, but then those animals aren't getting, you know, the top quality care, you know, and that's really important to me. So, but most animal companies like me, you know, most of them take really good care of their animals. Like we're in this because we love animals, not because, you know, for any other reason. It doesn't make us rich or anything. So most of the animals get like a lot of love and attention. And, you know, I think I would say that the vast majority of us really, you know, we're just really, really, we're animal lovers, you know, so.
So speaking of giving animals good care, let's say I want to be a dog trainer. Mm-hmm. Can you show me something?
Yeah, absolutely.
Alrighty.
Sure. One of the dogs that's very important when you have an animal on set, you have to teach it to come to a mark, just like an actor, to hit a specific cue on set. So I'll show you kind of how we start it. So this is a big block of wood. This is kind of like a beginner mark. So you put it down, and you can lure the animal onto it. You could call it a place, but we call it a mark. Good. So as soon as his 2 feet are on the mark, that means that that's the proper way. And then you give him treats for being on it and staying on it. So,
okay. Good boy.
Good boy. Back. Good stay. Can you sit? This is not anymore my mark.
All
right, I'm going to move the mark, and then I'll show you some of the other fun stuff. Sit. Good. Lie down. Down. Stay. Your head down. Head down. Try not. He says, no, I don't want to do that right now, Mom. Sit. Lie down. Please. Lie down. Head down. Good. Can you see that? Head down. Good. On your feet. Back up. Back up. Good. Sit. Good. Stay. Good boy. So there's lots of tricks, obviously, we have to train them to do. A lot of the stuff we train to do based on the script. But they have to, you know, learn to work with actors. Like, you know, he worked with you when he was a puppy. They have to learn to look at actors, not just at the trainer. He's got to look at you. And you know, they have to, you know, learn to pick things up in their mouth, to, you know, just to follow lots of different cues in a very small environment. So there's lots and lots of behaviors, and it's always endless. There's, you know, you're always constantly training a dog or a cat or whatever it is to do whatever it is that the script calls for it to do.
Right.
So good.
One thing I noticed about being on his mark is when you told him to sit, he brought his back feet forward, which most dogs, when they sit down, they kind of shuffle their front feet backwards. Yeah. Is that part of being on the mark?
Absolutely, yeah. Them? Well, you teach them body awareness. So, like, you know, when you're first teaching a dog, like if you're training a dog at home to do a sit, a lot of the time how you'll teach them is you'll take a treat and you'll just lure it over their head until their butt sits down, and then you give them the treat when they do the behavior you want. Another thing we use to train them to do things is, this is a clicker. You can buy these at any pet store. So if I was training, let's say, for example, I'm teaching Rhino to try to, it's something called sit pretty. So sit. So I've been working on this for a while with him. He's kind of big, so he hasn't quite learned it yet. But basically I'll show you. So I take the treat and I hold it up like this. So when he does it, you click and you pay him for it. So what I ultimately want to teach him is to do it without holding my hands, you know? So that way he's just in the air. So I lift it up. Good stick. And you give him the treat. So you're always gonna click whenever you want them to, when you're teaching them to do something. As soon as he lifts his legs off the ground, sit. Good. You know, you're clicking for that behavior. So, and when you're first teaching them, sit. Kind of come. sit.
Good. So he's trying to do it on his own, but he still has to hold on to my arm a little bit because he's a big dude, you know. And like, say you're teaching a dog, you want to teach a dog to circle, chase its tail or whatever, on your feet. Good. So you take a treat and you lure it around like that, and you click and you pay them for when they're actually doing the behavior. You're right. Marking that behavior.
Right.
So that's how they learn to do it. It's all positive reinforcement, the type of training we do.
Right.
You're rewarding them for the correct thing, and that way
rather than punishing
it.
Them for the wrong thing.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
You smell delicious.
Good. Sit. Yeah. Ready? Can you jump? Good. Ready? Jump. Good job. Good. All right. That was good, mister.
Alrighty. So thank you for allowing me to learn a little bit about training dogs. And
bye-bye.
Yeah. Thank you for getting candid with Kyle.
You're welcome. Thank you.